Well, that was an abrupt ending. Okay, welcome to part three. Picking up where I left off, I always try to give you guys both sides of the argument. So please read the piece from the U-boat commander and then think about the questions that are being asked at the end of the reading. All right, so what I'd like you to do is make sure you've read all three of these, thought about the questions, thought about the way they apply, and then when you are done reading them, you can begin to move on. All right, so I hope you've read them and you are well informed and ready to move on to the next idea. All right, so while this is taking place, of course, in the United States, every 4 years, we have an election. 1916 is no different. We have the election for president in 1916. And at this particular time, Woodrow Wilson is in a little bit of a difficulty. He needs some help in the process. Roosevelt had rejoined the Republican Party. So if you remember the election of 1912, Roosevelt split from the Republicans, allowing Wilson to get into the Oval Office. And so Wilson does a couple of things to try and help his position. He will appoint Louis Brandeis to the Supreme Court. That will make a number of people happy. He signs the Keating-Owen Child Labor, Bill. Workers' compensation bills get signed. All right. But the GOP will nominate a guy by the name of Charles Evan Hughes. And basically the election focuses on the war and whether or not we can stay out of the war in Europe. All right. Wilson is attacked on his foreign policy. Now, we are not spending time in class talking about America and Mexico, but it is very, very important that you read this section in the textbook on America and its involvement with Mexico, Pancho Villa's raids into southern United States territory in Arizona and New Mexico, and the fact that the United States sends the army into Mexico and chasing after Pancho Villa. So that's an important piece that we're not talking about in class, but I definitely want to make sure you are aware of, because you will be held accountable for that information. All right. So Hughes is complaining Wilson's foreign policy is bad. He's complaining that Wilson is weak on Mexico, and basically he will win the election pretty much because he's kept us out of the war, or that is the argument. All right, Wilson has kept us out of the war, and he promises to keep us out of the war. All right, and he does try to negotiate peace. Again, Wilson has this idealized version of what life should be like in the world in terms of trying to get everybody happy. And we talk about that on the next day when we talk about Wilson's 14 points, and those are important to understand. He does send envoys to London, Paris, Berlin. He tries to negotiate peace. That doesn't work out. He tries to declare peace without victory, which would help other people feel that the war is over and there's no winner, so no one has to feel like they lost. Again, none of these work out. So when he gives the speech, now the speech you have, it's there, you should take a look at it. It's his Peace Without Victory speech. It's delivered in January or February of 1917. It is one of the three pieces that you have that you should take a look at. In there, it's called Wilson's War Message to Congress. And in here, he lays out a number of items that are important for you to take a look at, such as we decry militarism. We're not going to build up militaries. There should not be secret alliances. And secret alliances are what helped get the countries involved in World War I involved in World War I. He believes in freedom of the seas. This is a direct attack against Germany and its unrestricted submarine warfare. Okay. He tries to come across with the idea that one nation should not be dominant in world affairs. Okay. Peace without victory. Again, I mentioned this earlier. It's very important for Wilson to feel that we have peace and there was no winner or no loser. And as you are well aware, if you have a winner, you feel good. And if you're a loser, you feel bad. And when you feel bad, you might want to go back at the people who won, or you want to get your revenge at them at some point in the future. However, his belief in the idea that there's peace without victory allows this to change completely. All right. And he also pushes through this idea on limitations for land and naval armaments. Now, Wilson's not going to see this come to fruition, but in the 1920s, this is going to take place. You're going to have the limitations on land and naval armaments, and you're going to see it. We talk about Kellogg-Briand back then. We're going to talk about the Washington Naval Conference. But again, that's for the future when we get to the 1920s. These are all things that Wilson is pushing, and it's not working. And of course, in 1917, when Germany resumes unrestricted warfare, all bets are off. All right, so you have Germany back doing unrestricted warfare on ships, unrestricted submarine warfare, I should say, on the high seas, where it's not doing either the Sussex Pledge or the Arabic Pledge anymore. Couple that with the Zimmerman telegram, and again, you're going to have to read that. We'll talk about it next visual. That's where Germany sends a message to Mexico saying, "Listen, if you go off and invade the southern United States and keep them busy after we win the war, we'll give you back all the land that America took from you in the Mexican-American War." So when that gets publicized, I think it's the British that intercept it, and it gets published in America's papers. That really gets Americans irate. And so Wilson is forced at this point to ask for a war declaration. So Wilson goes to Congress and asks for a declaration of war, and almost everybody in Congress will approve this war declaration. There are 50 members of Congress who do not. The most important person on this is a female representative from Montana by the name of Jeanette Rankin. And we'll hear her name again because, although in World War I she's one of 50 people, she is the only one in World War II that will cast a no vote for a declaration of war with Japan. All right. So the United States is now officially embroiled in World War I, and this will be the thing that gets us going for the next year, and it sets the stage for tomorrow's lesson. All right, so there's three things that I want you to read. One is I want you to read Wilson's war message. And when you read Wilson's war message, please take a look at what he's proposing in there. Okay, some of these concepts and ideals are brand new, they're earth-shattering. They focus around this whole concept of progressivism and how things can change. Remember, you're now looking at a progressive president's foreign policy and Wilson's idealism. Okay? And the second thing is read the Zimmerman telegram. It is not very long, but imagine the reaction of Americans when the telegram is published to Germany, basically telling another country, "Yeah, sure, go to war with America and don't worry about it. When we win, we'll give you back all your land again." I don't quite know how Germany thought they would be able to do that, but that is what they propose. And the last thing I'd like you to read, please, is Wilson's request for war to Congress. All right. Now, this is important. When you look at this and Wilson's war message, they're going to seem similar, but they're not. They are not identical. So please read them both and take some time to assess these three documents. It's important. All right. So here's the time. I'll pause the piece for you to read them over. And when you're done, please hit the play button again. Okay, so I hope you've had an opportunity to read those three pieces over, and you are now infused with even more knowledge from our primary sources than you had just by listening to me. And we are going to conclude this lesson with a look at the essential question that we asked in the very beginning, and that is, was America destined to become involved in World War I? What do you think? Were we destined? Was it our destiny? Did we have no choice but to get involved in World War I? And when you think about this question, you really need to think about America's position on the world stage at this time. Where were we? How big had we become? How had we gotten here? Remember, 17 years earlier, we had just won the Spanish-American War. 20 years earlier, in 1897, we weren't even a world power. We were on the verge of becoming a world power, but I don't believe many Americans thought of themselves as a world power. Yes, you had Josiah Strong and Albert Beveridge, and you had all the people talking about white man's burden and white supremacy and the Anglo-Saxon race and all that stuff. But again, this is simply 20 years after the Spanish-American War, after America becomes a colonial imperial power. How do we go from suddenly being a regional power to a world power? To the point that we can actually afford to send our army overseas and produce and affect a war that's taking place on another continent. So these are the kind of questions you should be thinking about and asking amongst yourselves. Feel free to listen to this lesson with a friend. Feel free to listen to this lesson with a colleague. Feel free to listen to this lesson by yourself, whatever works for you. But as you discover in class, the more you talk about these things, the more there's a dialogue between more than yourself, then the opportunity becomes greater for you to have a higher end of learning for this. All right? So that concludes lesson one for World War I. It is, was America destined to become involved in World War I? If you have any questions, please do not hesitate to ask them when we meet in class the next day. Hope you have a great day. Bye-bye.